Hello and welcome. My name is Sam, and in this lesson, we are going to be talking about everyone's favorite tense, the present perfect tense. Maybe you've studied this tense before. Maybe you've studied it many times before, but please stay with us because hopefully this will be a useful review and maybe you will even learn something new. In this lesson, we will be looking at the form, so how you use it in a sentence, also the negatives and the questions. Then we will be looking at the pronunciation, so which parts are contracted and which parts are stressed in a sentence. And then we will be looking at 5 different situations where we use the present perfect, where we use it on its own, but also how we use it with just, already, yet, how it compares to the past simple, and also how to use it with for and since. So we're going to be looking at a lot of information, so please go and get a piece of paper and a pen, make some notes, and remember that you can always press pause and rewind if you need to. Are you ready? Let's have a look at the form together. And let's look in this sentence, I have finished work. So the form, as you probably know, is with the subject, the auxiliary verb have, and the past participle of the main verb, the main action. So a little bit about past participles. There is some good news and some bad news. The good news is that past participles of regular verbs are exactly the same as the past simple. You simply add ed. So live becomes lived, want becomes wanted, and finish becomes finished. Notice the difference in pronunciation of those ed endings. When it comes to irregular past participles, there are no rules. Unfortunately, you just have to memorize them. You can find a list of them at the back of any good grammar book or course book. You can definitely find them online, but please don't try and memorize them all at once. There are too many, and that's not a useful use of your time. Start by trying to memorize the ones that are useful for you, for your life, for your interests. So for example, if you are a swimmer, if you enjoy swimming, then it is useful for you to know that the past participle of swim is swum. But if you don't enjoy swimming, if you are much more interested in shopping, for example, then it's more useful for you to learn that the past participle of spend is spent. So personalize it. Start with the ones that are important to you. It's always a good idea to write them in a sentence as well. And again, in a sentence that you would actually say, something you would need to say in your real life. So let's look at the form in a little bit more detail. You'll notice that the only one that's different is the third person singular. So he, she, and it. That's the only one you have to remember isn't have, but has. But when we're speaking naturally, we don't normally say, I have finished, or he has finished. We much more naturally contract the subject and the auxiliary verb. So I have, we naturally say I've. You have, you've. He has, he's. She's, it's. Slight difference in pronunciation there to notice. With he and she, it's a z sound, and with it, it's a s sound. But the key part of the tense isn't really the subject or the auxiliary verb. The key piece of information is the main verb, so the past participle. So when you're saying it naturally, that's the one that you want to stress. That's the one we focus on. So I've finished. You've finished. He's finished. To make the negative, we simply add not after the auxiliary verb. So, have not, haven't, has not, hasn't. Again, when speaking naturally, we contract them so they sound like one word. Haven't, hasn't. And when asking a question, we simply swap the subject and the auxiliary verb. So we start the question with have or has. Have you finished? Has he finished? When answering the question, we naturally use a short answer. So yes, I have. No, I haven't. Or yes, he has. No, he hasn't. Another little thing to notice is that when it's a positive or affirmative answer, we use the full form. But when it's a negative answer, we use the contraction, haven't or hasn't. Okay, so now we know how to form the present perfect and how to say it. Let's look at when we use it. So, situation number one. We use it to give news. So this is new information, something we didn't know before. For example, have you heard? Jen and Joe have got married. Ben's become a father. Or do you want to try the last one with me? My mum's finally retired. So in these situations, we don't know when these things happened, only that they happened sometime before now. Related to this, situation two is when we use the present perfect to talk about something that happened in the very recent past. We don't know when exactly, but it has a present result. For example, I've finished work. She's spilt coffee down her top. Or do you want to try the last one? They've made dinner. To help give us an idea of time, we often use the present perfect with three little words: just, already, and yet. We use just to talk about a time very recently, just a moment ago, probably. I've just finished work. I'm on my way. We use already to say that something happened earlier than expected, so maybe we're a little bit surprised. It's only 11 o'clock and I've already finished work. Do you want to meet for a coffee? So we use just and already in affirmative or positive sentences, and you've probably noticed that it goes before the main verb, so before the past participle. We use yet to ask if something has happened or to say that something hasn't happened. So we use it in questions and negatives, and it goes at the end of the sentence or the question.
Have you finished work yet?
No, I haven't yet. Sorry. If you watch American films or American television, you might have noticed that in American English, they sometimes use the past simple, where in British English, we use the present perfect. So for example, they might say,
did you finish work yet?
Yes, I just finished. I'm on my way. Reason number four, we use the present perfect to talk about our life experiences. So things that have happened in our life. We don't specify when. The focus is simply on the fact that they happened, and we are more interested in the event. Maybe it happened once, maybe it's happened many times, but that is the focus, not the time. So for example, about reading, I could say, I've read Pride and Prejudice many times. I love it. Or about films, I could say, I've only seen a few superhero films. Or about my experiences with food, I could say, I've eaten pizza in Naples, the birthplace of pizza. So in all three of these examples, the focus is on what I read, what I've watched, and what I've eaten. not when it happened. And this is when we can compare the present perfect and the past simple, because often when talking about our life experiences, we use both. The conversation will start with the present perfect and then continue using the past simple.
Have you ever been to Iceland?
Yes, I have. I went a couple of years ago and it was beautiful. So let's have a look at that more closely. We use the present perfect when we were talking about general time. So in the question, there was a little word that gave us a clue. The word was ever. And ever basically means in your life. So your life is a very open time. There is no specific moment we are talking about. So we're using the present perfect. When I started answering the question, yes, I went a couple of years ago, then I switched to the past simple. And I did that because I was being specific about when, a couple of years ago. So the little rule is, if you're talking in general, you don't know when, use the present perfect. If you do know when, use the past simple. Another little clue is to look for time references or time markers in sentences. Are they talking about finished time or unfinished time? For example, your life is unfinished because you are still alive, and 2 years ago is finished because we are now in a different year. So let's have a quick look at those time markers. And together, let's decide if they are referring to finished time or unfinished time. Number one, 3 months ago. Ago tells us it's in the past, it's finished. This month, it uses the word this, which tells us it's unfinished. This week also uses the word this, so unfinished. Last week uses the word last, so finished. Do you want to try the next two? Yesterday. Finished, well done. And today is unfinished, well done. And reason number five, we use the present perfect to describe actions or states that started in the past and are still true now. And to do this, we often use two little words, for and since. And this is because these words help us connect the past with the present. And let's look at two examples. He's worked here since May. If we wanted to say the same thing with for, we could say he's worked here for 2 months. And the difference between for and since is that for describes the period of time, the duration, and since describes the moment that period of time started. So it's a fixed point in time. Let's look at two other examples, and maybe you can help me with for or since. They've been married 3 years. They've been married for 3 years, because 3 years is a duration. They've been married 2016. They've been married since 2016. Well done. We hope you enjoyed our video today, and we hope you're feeling more confident with the present perfect, how to form it in a sentence, how to say it, and the lots of different ways and situations you can use it. If you are feeling more confident, why not write us a comment, a sentence using the present perfect, maybe talking about your life experiences, your travels, your friends, your family. We really look forward to hearing from you. And if you don't want to miss any of our future lessons, and why would you? Then please subscribe. The subscribe button is just there. Have you found it? And you can also share this lesson with your friends, don't forget. And we hope to see you again very, very soon.